Good evening, I'm Jose Cardenas. An ASU professor receives the most prestigious award from the world's top applied mathematics organization. Plus, we'll get to know Reverend Fernando Camou, the first U.S.-born Hispanic priest to be ordained in the Roman Catholic Diocese of Phoenix in more than 35 years, and learn about a federal aid program helping homeowners refinance their mortgages. All this coming up on Horizonte.
Funding for Horizonte is made possible by contributions by the Friends of Eight, members of your Arizona PBS station.
Thank you for joining us. The 8th International Congress on Industrial and Applied Mathematics was held in Beijing, China. ASU Regents Professor Carlos Castillo Chavez was there to receive the most prestigious award from the Society for Industrial and Applied Mathematics, SIAM, the world's top applied mathematics organization. Joining me now to talk about the award is ASU Regents Professor Carlos Castillo Chavez. Professor Castillo Chavez, welcome back to Horizonte.
Nice to be
here. It seems like every time we have you on the show, you've gotten another award, but this is one of the most significant. Tell us, first of all, when we talk about applied mathematics, what's the significance of that?
There are different perspectives. One is to develop new tools that allow us to apply mathematics in different areas. And the other has to do with use mathematics to solve real life problems, like the problems of Ebola or HIV or problems of sustainability or the environment. And I'm more from the second school than the first.
And in fact, you've been recognized for your work in connection with the SARS outbreak.
Yes, we did one of the first papers on the SARS outbreak predicting the number of cases in Canada before the epidemic ended, and we hit it right on the money.
And you were also involved in dealing with the Ebola outbreak, weren't you?
Yes, in fact, we also wrote a paper predicting that there were going to be not as many cases as had been advertised, and we predicted that there were going to be 6,800 cases by September, while many other groups predicted that they were going to be in the millions by the end of the year. We didn't think that was the case, and that turned out to be correct.
So as I indicated in my opening comments, you've been recognized many, many times. You're internationally known, certainly nationally known. What's so special about this particular award?
Well, it's a distinguished service to the profession, and typically are given by an individual for their contributions to applied mathematics, but also for their contributions to the community in terms of how you help applied mathematics spread around the world, and also for contributions to mentoring the new generations of mathematicians. And in my particular case, I'm very proud of the fact that I have devoted the last 30 years of my life to trying to provide access and opportunities for diverse populations in applied mathematics, particularly U.S. Latinos.
And was that part of the basis for your selection to receive this award?
I hope so. It is a distinguished service for the profession. The award mentions my work on ecology and epidemiology and other areas of applied mathematics and my contributions to mentoring and to other areas of applied mathematics. So it is a great award because it encompasses everything that I have done in applied mathematics, and therefore I'm very proud that I was recognized by that.
Now, this was your most recent award, but earlier in the month of August, you received another recognition. Tell us about that one.
Yes, the Mathematical Association of America was celebrating their 100th year of their birth, and they selected five individuals to make major presentations at a meeting in Washington, D.C. So I was given the opportunity to speak at this event. In fact, it has been recorded. Someday we're going to be online. And it's very important when you have one of the largest associations of the world in mathematics, and it's different than SIAM, but a different association, giving you that forum to express your ideas about applied mathematics. In this particular case, I talk about Ebola. Well, it has been a very good week to me, so to speak.
Now, there's another one coming up, another award,
yes.
And this one from the Victoria Foundation.
That's correct. That's on September 9. The Victoria Foundation, thanks to some donation by the Pasquayaki tribe, created the Bill Velez Award. And Bill Velez Award is a mathematician from Arizona, native of Arizona, who has done tremendous contribution to mathematics from our sister institution, the University of Arizona, all his life. He's a graduate from that university and has spent all his life and that institution. He was a former president of the Society for the Advancement of Chicanos and Native Americans in Science, so he's a true giant. So being recognized by an award named after him and being the first one to be recognized is a great honor to me.
And in addition to many of the honorifics that you have, you are a Regents Professor, as we noted. You are the Joaquin Bustos Professor of Mathematics. That's another very significant recognition.
Yes, when I was appointed here, they created a special chair professorship, and I suggested that it be named after Joaquin Bustos Jr. His parents were custodians of Tempe Elementary Schools. The school is named after his parents. And he was a major force in providing opportunities to Native American, Latinos, and essentially people from poor families in the state of Arizona. And when he passed away, I thought that it was the most appropriate thing to do. So that's the first chair professorship named after a U.S. Latino in the United States. And again, tremendous honor for me to be recognized after two giants from the state of Arizona.
And you very much followed his lead in terms of your own work. We've made reference to it earlier in the interview, working with young Latinos and other minority students to get them involved in mathematics, which is not a typical, at least to date, hasn't been a typical course of study. Tell us about that and what the current status is. Is it getting better or deteriorating? And what can we expect in the future?
There's been some progress, and certainly at Arizona State University under President Crow, there has been tremendous advancement and support for these opportunities. So in fact, the situation has improved somewhat, but still, we haven't crossed that threshold where you suddenly will see great numbers of Latinos going into STEM disciplines in the massive numbers that we would expect. Nevertheless, we have developed these programs at Arizona State that go from 10th grade all the way to the undergraduate, graduate, postdoctoral positions, and faculty positions to create the kind of leadership that will continue to advance these ideas, not only at Arizona State, but across the nation.
And how do you identify, in 10th grade, what do you do to reach into the high schools and identify these students who might prosper in your program?
I really believe in the model of access, excellence, and impact. So what we do at Arizona State is we go to the poorest schools in the country, also in the in the Navajo Nation, and we recruit the best students from the schools that they have. So we don't look for the people that do the best on this course. We tend to be the children of parents with higher socioeconomic status. But we go to the most disadvantaged schools and pick the best students from those schools. And it turns out to be that once they get the support, the opportunities that they have, all of them do well. All of them become aerospace engineers or mathematicians or scientists. It never fails. So it's just providing that access and that opportunity at 10th grade and then bring them back from 11th grade and 12th grade, that's enough to provide them the kind of access that will change their lives and the lives of their families.
Professor, just one last question. The number of women who are seeking careers in mathematics has traditionally been low, and I would assume even more so for Latinas. Is that still the case, and what kind of progress are we making there?
For Latinas continue to be tremendously more. In fact, it would be very difficult to identify a major mathematician that is Latina, and that's a very sad state of affairs. In terms of participation as undergraduate or graduate students, the numbers have increased, but in terms of the number of Latinas that achieve the status of associate professor or full professor or have a very distinguished career, the situation in the country is still tragic across most universities. It's very rare to find a full professor that is Latina, not only in applied mathematics or mathematics, but also in most STEM disciplines. And that's something that needs to be addressed directly.
And I know you'll continue to address it. Thank you so much for joining us on Horizonte, and congratulations on your most recent award.
A pleasure to be here. Thank you. Thank you.
June, Reverend Fernando Camou became the U.S.-born first Hispanic priest to be ordained in the Roman Catholic Diocese of Phoenix in more than 35 years. Join me as we get to know Reverend Fernando Camou. Congratulations on your ordination.
Thank you very much, Diaz.
I'm sure people have commented on how young you look. How old are you?
Do I have to say? I'm 25 years old. And yes, most people are just like, you're so young, what are you doing?
And in fact, I didn't know this, but there's an age limit and
yeah, you just barely made it. Yeah, I couldn't be any younger, actually. 25 is the minimum age for ordination. 24, the bishop can dispense if he sees it's adequate. Any less, though, the pope has to give permission, so.
Have you always wanted to be a priest?
No, it wasn't until I was in high school that I actually started to consider it as an option. Up until that point, I knew a lot of priests in my life. A lot of priests were friends with my parents. But, you know, they'd ask me, like, oh, have you considered a priest? And I'd be like, no, we'll see.
We've got a picture that we want to put on the screen of you and your family. It's a large family.
Yeah.
Like a number of boys.
You see there's five of us siblings, and then my two older sisters are both married. The oldest, Maria, has five little boys. She just formed her own little basketball team. And my sister Rosa has two on the left side of the picture. And she's got her third one on the way, another boy.
So what made you decide you wanted to be a priest?
It was about the time when I was in high school that I really discovered my faith as my personal personal relationship with our Lord. It wasn't just what my parents taught me anymore. And during that time, I met a seminarian for the first time. And in talking to him, I asked him just, you know, what's seminary about? And he basically said very boring things, nothing interesting. But in that conversation, I received a lot of peace and a real sense that, very clear, God wanted me to give this a try. So what did I do? I started dating a girl and I went to college. I put it off for a good 3 years. And 3 years later, again, I came to a realization that I was ignoring something in my heart. And I had told myself, if I'm gonna get married, this is the girl I'm gonna marry, the same girl I had been dating. And but as soon as I said those words in my heart, I felt an emptiness. Something was missing.
So you went to college first. Mm-hmm. Where'd you go?
I went to GCC.
And then from there, you went to seminary.
Yeah, basically. I was ready to transfer to ASU. And I went to the Josephinum, which is in Columbus, Ohio. I spent 3 years there, got my bachelor's in arts in philosophy for the first 3 years. And that initial formation is also the formation of how to be a good Christian man, how to develop a good prayer life. And is this really a call from God, or is this, you know, kind of the discernment phase is what those three
How
first
did you
three.
Explain this decision to your girlfriend?
That was a difficult conversation for sure. And I said it in the worst possible way, actually. I just said, my feelings for seminary are stronger than my feelings for this relationship. I'm pretty sure those are the words I used. Obviously, it did not go well. But I started to receive a lot of peace. Like I was finally starting to be sincere with what I was feeling in my heart, as opposed to kind of just going with what was good and what worked. A true sense that God doesn't just want us to do good things. He's got a specific mission that fits our personalities and our hearts the best. And he's got that, the higher plan.
And then what happens next? Is that when you went to Rome?
After the first 3 years in cloudy, dark Columbus, I went off to the Eternal City in Rome for another 4 years. That was a shock when they told me they wanted me to go there. I was like, I've never.
That's not typical?
No, in fact, at the time, nobody in our diocese studied in Rome. So it was not expected. And it was a struggle. It was also amazing. Obviously, Rome is an incredible city. There's so much.
So why did they want you to go there?
Good question, ask the bishop.
They never
get him on
you.
The show, yeah. I'd like to know.
Yeah. Well, you learned Italian.
All of my classes were in Italian. So they gave us 2 months of immersion and then sent us into grad studies in Italian, which was an adventure. The first couple months were like, I don't know if I can do this. But after a while, you get the hang of it.
So now you're about, what, 7 years into the journey to the
priesthood? Yeah, 7 years now since I joined seminary.
Over that period of time, any second thoughts that maybe you should have gotten married to that girl whose heart you broke?
I describe those 7 years as the most difficult years of my life, as well as the most joyful years of my life. And I never doubted. I always had a great peace in the depths of my heart. When I really asked myself, is this really what God wants? I had a great sense of peace. But it wasn't easy. Just, you know, living in community, the studies. I was an engineer. I was pursuing engineer before. So I was not a reader. And now I found myself reading not just books, but philosophy. And I don't know how many people crack open one of those books, but they're not fun reads.
So the studying was part of the difficulty. But what about the basic decision to become a priest as opposed to becoming an engineer, getting married, having a family?
It was actually one of the easiest decisions I've ever made, because I was just so filled with peace, and I think that's ultimately how we discern what is God's will and what is our will. God's will comes with great peace and great joy, and it's not easy. It wasn't easy for any of the apostles. They all got martyred, but.
Things have improved since then.
Things have improved. We've come a long ways. Yes, indeed.
So we've got a picture of what this all led to, your ordination, that we want to put on the screen. This was what, a couple of months ago?
Yes, this is June 27th. So when this show airs, it will be 2 months.
And you are now assigned to St. Thomas Aquinas?
That's right, in Avondale.
Tell us about your duties there.
I get to be a priest, make myself totally available to those who want to see a priest. I say masses there regularly. My greatest, greatest challenge, but greatest joy has been visiting the sick. I've gotten to anoint a man who is dying. He died within 24 hours of my anointing him and praying with his family. And then I got to bury him. And just being invited into this very intimate moment in a family's time, family's life, was a great privilege. And then to accompany those people on that journey. I had one experience where I got a call from a man who said, "Father, I can't take this pain any longer. I don't have a reason to live. I don't want to live anymore." So he asked for anointing. I prayed with him, gave him the anointing of the sick. And then I just asked him about his life, and we started a chat. Before, you know, 30 minutes had passed, we were laughing, telling stories. And as I walked away, he says to me, "Father, I think I'm going to be all right. I'm ready for more." And that, I think, is kind of the nutshell of what this life is about, is bringing Christ to people who will give them hope, who will give them joy in their lives.
And I can understand why that would be a particular joyous moment for you. Any challenges, anything you've run into in these first few months that makes you think maybe this is a little harder than you thought it was going to be?
I haven't had a boring day yet, and I miss boring days sometimes. But every day is full. There's always stuff going on. And it's challenging to constantly be on my toes, to keep up with the schedule and keep up with a number of people who want to see a priest. But that's nothing. I mean, who gets to live life without serious challenges? If you really love life, you're going to really experience some challenges. And I think the greatest example are my sisters. I just mentioned my oldest sister has 5 boys. That by no means is an easy task. But I've never seen my sister more joyful, because she's really discovered, she really exemplifies how true love is found in the giving. And the true joy is found in spreading that. And I think that's what this life is all about. So.
Father Camou, congratulations
again.
Thank
you very much. It's a joy to be here.
And thank you for joining us on Horizonte. Hope
Absolutely.
To see you again in the future.
Great. Have a great night.
To find out more information about what's on Horizonte, go to azpbs.org and click on the Horizonte tab at the top of the screen. There you can access many features to become a more informed Horizonte viewer. Watch interviews by clicking on the video button or by scrolling down to the bottom of the page for the most recent segments. Learn about more specific topics like arts and culture and immigration. You can also find out what's on Horizonte for the upcoming week. If you would like an RSS feed, a podcast, or you want to buy a video, that's all on our website too. Other features include our collection of website links and a special page for educators. While you're there, show your support for Horizonte with just one click. Discover all that's on Horizonte. Visit azpbs.org, Horizonte, today.
Watch sneak previews of what's coming soon to 8. Go to azpbs.org/previews today.
The Home Affordable Refinance Program, known as HARP, is a federal program set up by the Federal Housing Finance Agency to help homeowners refinance their mortgages. The HARP program has been extended through December 2016. Here now to talk about the program is Reginald Gibbons, Foreclosure Assistance Administrator for the Arizona Department of Housing. Mr. Gibbons, thank you for joining us on Horizonte. Your program works both independently and hand-in-hand with HARP and other federal programs. Tell us a little bit about what you do and about your state program that you're employed with.
Yes, and again, thank you for having me here. I work at the Arizona Department of Housing, and I administer the Save Our Home AZ program, and it's a mortgage assistance program federally funded by the U.S. Department of Treasury, but designed, developed, implemented, and overseen by the U.S. Arizona Department of Housing here locally, and we assist consumers with homeownership retention, transition, things that occurred as a result of the housing crisis.
And in particular, with respect to HARP, which is a program by which people can refinance their homes, how does your program, Save Our Homes, interact with them?
HARP, and H-A-R-P stands for Home Affordable Refinance Program, enables consumers who owe more on their homes than it's worth to be able to refinance at market rates. And so that in and of itself can assist them in reducing their monthly mortgage payment by reducing the interest rate, extending the term on their mortgage. What the Save Our Home AZ program does in concert with that is we provide principal reduction assistance. So if you would, for an example, if a consumer owes $250,000 on a home that's worth $200,000, they can receive $50,000 of principal reduction assistance. That reduction in the principal further enhances the reduction in the payment, and therefore they could see a reduction in their payment without necessarily extending their term, or they could extend the term. But either way, it allows them to further accelerate the reduction of their principal, returning to a position of equity far sooner than they would otherwise.
So how does it work? If somebody qualifies for HARP, mm-hmm. and they meet the further criterion that the value of the home is worth less than the mortgage on it, is there anything else they need to do to qualify for your program?
There are, and they pretty much go hand in hand. I like to say there's five core elements to qualifying for the assistance under the Save Our Home AZ program. Has to be an Arizona property. Has to be a primary residence. We don't assist with investment properties. Their income has to be within 150% of the area median income, which is very liberal and allows many consumers to qualify. And they have to owe more on the house than it's worth, as you mentioned. And then just lastly, they couldn't have excessively borrowed money against the property. We use what we call a 150% equity stripping rule. If you bought it for $200,000, you can't owe more than three.
So if they've gone out and the reason for the high debt is personal credit lines, they probably wouldn't qualify.
Possibly, but again, 150%. So somebody who purchased for $200,000 could owe as much as three. So you have $100,000 of additional debt that you could have added to the home and still qualify for the assistance.
How successful has the HARP program been? You hear criticisms that not much impact has been made by a lot of the initiatives from the federal government. What about HARP?
Well, I think in and of itself, HARP has been successful and provided meaningful assistance to many households. When you add to it the benefit of Save Our Home AZ, that assistance and the benefit becomes exponential because they didn't realize they would see principal reduction. In fact, some consumers who come to us for program assistance, because we have to promote ourselves and then make them aware of the benefits of HARP, if you will, who may not qualify for HARP, can still qualify for principal reduction assistance under our program, as well as some monthly mortgage assistance. And so there's various components, if you will, that enables them over time to position themselves for the highest and best possible outcome.
How many Arizona families have benefited from your program?
We've assisted nearly 4,000 Arizona households program to date. We assist approximately 1,000 households monthly with monthly mortgage assistance. Those are households who've yet to return to self-sufficiency, and so they need their payments subsidized until we can either achieve an affordable modification or they can increase their household earnings so that they can adequately sustain the mortgage on their own.
As we noted at the beginning, HARP was scheduled to sunset at the end of this year. It's not going to go on for another year. Your program, I assume, will continue for the same period of time?
Yes, and in fact, our program goes through 2017, so we have a year beyond HARP. We're hoping to make the most of this extension of the HARP, if you will, because the refinance is nice, but some consumers, as I mentioned previously, who aren't able to qualify for refinance can get what they call a recast or reamortization of their loan. So if we can pay down the principal, still that $50,000, $60,000, and then recalculate their payment on the remaining term with the remaining rate, they still see a significant reduction of income, which is how we're able to graduate them to self-sufficiency.
So other ways to benefit.
Yes.
Thank you so much for joining us on Horizonte to talk about them.
Thank you for having me.
And that's our show for tonight from all of us here at Horizonte and Arizona PBS. Thank you for watching. I'm Jose Cardenas. Have a good evening.
Funding for Horizonte is made possible by contributions by the Friends of Eight, members of your Arizona PBS station.